I started drawing younger than I can remember, and I drew all the time.
What I get from a comic, the way it works, the way it's put together, it's unique. I've become fascinated by the way the visual narrative actually works, the way it flows, the way one picture leads into another one.
This is Hope Street. Hope Street Studios. Welcome to Hope Street. No puke today. Then this is my room.
This last year I've been working between 6 and 7 days a week. I'm very often in here till last bus, and when it's near deadline, or if the work's just going really well, I'll sometimes just stay in.
One of the projects that I'm working on just now is called Jupiter's Legacy. You've got older heroes from the 30s. They're altruistic. Everything that they do for the greater good. And then they've got these children and grandchildren who've simply grown up this way, the equivalent of your kind of Paris Hiltons. They've got superpowers and they're famous and they've got advertising contracts and they get invited to all the A-lister parties and all the rest of it. But they're a different generation. They've got a different mindset from the parents. When I get the first script in, it's always the same process for me. I read it and reread it until it becomes really quite clear in my mind. Even at that stage, you actually start making decisions about atmosphere and layout and the way you're going to put it together.
I have to be thinking about the easiest, simplest way of making it clear what's happening, but it also has to be interesting, because sometimes the easiest, simplest way isn't visually very satisfying.
Page 13, we've got a bunch of fire engines flying past, and our two heroes, Hutch and Jason, a father and son, are walking up the street. Then the kid goes into a public lavatory, out the skylight window, and flies away. His name's Jason. So far in the script, he hasn't got a superhero name. This is the first thing that he's done. He's got changed and flown up into the sky.
His father is the son of some famous supervillain, but he doesn't actually have powers himself.
His mother's fully superpowered, but they don't actually know that he's out doing this. I've read the script often enough that I see the whole thing as a selection of still images, which I think are going to work best. But often I have more than one still image for each panel, and it's not always just a question of taking the still image that looks the best in isolation. You have to actually choose the still image that looks the best within the sequence.
Sometimes I come up with it quite quickly, and sometimes it takes ages. But irrespective, it always takes a good long while to actually draw it up. Considerably longer than it takes to read it and have a look at it as you're flicking through a comic.
I was born in 1968. In Glasgow here. And I always loved drawing, and I always thought I was quite good, you know, like even when I didn't have anything to compare it to. I would say my single biggest influence from when I was younger was the Scottish artist Dudley D. Watkins. He did the Bruins and Oor Willie for decades and decades, and Desperate Dan and lots of things. I used to read them in my grandparents' house on a Sunday. I was the best drawer in class in primary school, and I was best in my class at secondary school. And Then I went to art school, and then I started freelancing, and then I drifted into comics. From the thumbnails on the script, I make page layouts, which I generally do digitally now.
I'm going to have three skylights here, and this one is going to be opened. So we'll have the boy going in here, and a head and shoulders coming out here, and then flying away in the distance. And then I'll have the cop standing here with his back to us, and the guy in the hat standing here. And then we'll go to this shot of young Jason flying up towards us. I often draw it like that just to get the proportions right, and then put his trousers in, you know, when I'm doing the final line work in pencil on paper. I've drawn out a character design for Jason wearing the white Under Armour that he wears for his soccer. And he's got his rucksack that he just carries about with him anyway. So that's where his jeans and shirt go. He keeps his cons and socks on. So the only bit of kit that he actually has to put on really is his wee homemade diamond mask and a bandana. The colours are chosen because they tie in with his grandfather, who was the main character from the first three issues, the Utopian. The whole look is just kind of reminiscent of that. Grant sat and just ran through a casual synopsis for the whole thing, and it just sounded amazing. It was pretty exciting, you know, and it was one of those moments. Classic 50s Superman was part of the aesthetic of it, but I also had to come up with a way of drawing Superman that was just natural to me. So it's just a kind of, this is what Superman looks like in my mind, but because it's me that's drawing it, it does have, it's got a hint of kind of desperate Dan about it.
It's quite a big story. It's a big human drama, and it's about accepting your own mortality. Thanks to a cunning plan by Lex Luthor, Superman ends up flying too close to the sun. His cells start deteriorating. So it's kind of like the equivalent of cancer for him. So he realises he's got about a year to live, and there's a number of things that he has to put in order before he dies.
Since the dawn of modern humans, storytelling's been one of the main ways that we communicate ideas. In the same way that I'm sure soldiers going into war would tell stories about great heroes to G people up and inspire them, you know. Most fictional characters are either kind of there for cautionary purposes or to inspire us, to be like role models for us. I mean, you do get drawn into what you're drawing, of course. There's two issues of the 12-issue run that have Bizarro in them. Bizarro's the mad, upside-down, topsy-turvy type Superman. And everything's just broken and back to front. I was actually at my most stressed when I was drawing those issues. The deadlines were completely short right from the start. There was the stress of that, but also the exchange rate between dollars and pounds was really poor at that point as well, and I thought I was going to lose the house and stuff like that, so it was a really frantic time. I actually think the drawing's slightly looser and slightly more frantic in that, but I was certainly looser and more frantic when I was drawing it. Grant was delighted, of course. He was hoping I'd have a full breakdown to make the issue really good.
Two mods have just gone by in Lumberettas. I haven't seen a mod for ages. Because I'm drawing from my imagination all the time, there is a general look to most of the characters. I always think it's a bit like if you go to a family wedding and
pretty much everybody in the room looks vaguely like another few people in the room. You know, there's slightly too many connections for it to be anything other than a family wedding. I often like do wee sketches of people in the street or in the train station or on the bus or whatever. Sometimes it's for really simple things, like just here's a convincing way that tired people sit when they're sitting in a bus. I know a lot of comic artists and they'll say, even if they're not trying to get a likeness, they'll be thinking in terms of like Clint Eastwood for this character or whatever, you know. But with me, it tends more to be people I know or combinations of different people that I know.
These are the roughs for the Walking Dead cover. She was based loosely on a teacher from my primary school.
She seemed to me at the time, when I was like 6 or 7, she seemed like about 100 years old, and she had horn-rimmed glasses. She was incredibly skinny and wrinkly.
So you turned her into a zombie?
Well, you know, I thought, you know, like, it's that way, like, you know, you must get granny zombies, you know, so... I'm wanting the city to be drawn with enough detail that it looks convincingly like a city from the air. But when it comes to colouring, I'll ask Peter to keep the line work of the foreground figure in solid black and drop the line work of the background back a bit so that there's a little bit more of a distinction. When I'm working digitally, it's very easy to change things and I don't feel precious about it. But when it comes to actually doing fine detail, even though this is a really sophisticated piece of technology, the feeling of being like, it's like trying to touch your finger like against the glass and it never quite meets. There's something like that feeling when you're working with this. It's just not quite perfect. And the level of sensitivity you've got with the tip of a pencil on the paper, it's like there isn't a gap there at all.
There we go. Ready to print this out in blue and then start doing the finished line work.
We've got eggs. Are you wanting egg? Ben, can you boil the kettle?
Yeah, sure. Hope Street Studios is a pretty nice place to work, you know. We have a slow kind of turnover of people. Some people stay about for years, other people are just in for a few months and move on, but the way it goes, it's always word of mouth. All the people who've ended up here have been friends or colleagues of the people who already work here.
You know, you can be a tribute act, or you can be inspired by various different sources, and that helps shape you. As a teenager, I had Katsuhiro Otomo, the Japanese guy that did Akira. He was depicting a world that had enough detail that it was entirely believable, you know? Cities crumbling, and there was a sense of scale and a sense of place. The fact that he didn't resort to sketching in areas of the city in the background that weren't actually depicted with some degree of accuracy. Yeah, I think that's one of the things that kind of really helped sell that whole world that he was presenting. Over the years, I've never managed to get any faster, even though I've become generally more efficient with all the different skills that I need. When I started out, it was all about just keeping things clear and easy to understand. And over the years, the more I've learned about storytelling, the more I've learned about the way you can lead the eye around the page, or the way you can encourage somebody to move very slowly from left to right across the panel. All this stuff I've become so kind of fascinated by and engrossed in the way it actually works. I find that I spend more and more time planning the pages than I do actually drawing up the finished artwork.